the nobodies, to the abandoned, who couldn't see and the pain was a plan. Looking back now, Lord, I can say thank you. Now let me tell you who I am.
How do you do? Greetings in the wonderful name of Jesus the Christ. It is our annual tradition to count down to the start of a new year. I believe the ending of a year and the beginning of a new year is one of the most critical times of the entire year. The countdown to the new year serves two purposes: one, to finish the year strong, and the other, to have a great start to the next year. I hope you will allow me to be your guide as we travel these last 50 days of this year. Every day, we will share a word to help us end the year strong while equally preparing for the new year. Let's get started.
Welcome to the Words to Empower podcast, featuring Bishop Frank Stewart, pastor of the Acts Ministry in Conway and North Little Rock, and now, Pastor Stewart.
Welcome back to your Acts Ministry podcast. We're going to finish up on discipline. The last 2 days we've talked about discipline. We're going to talk about it one more day and move forward. This is day number 33. Day 33. Of our countdown. Started 50 days out. This is 33. I tell people 33 is the crucifixion number. It is the crucifixion number. Jesus was 33 when he was crucified. We're talking about discipline. Discipline. The scripture we start off with is what Paul says to Timothy: God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, sound mind. And we looked at that sound mind in other translations, and in the Greek it means self-discipline, sound mind, self-discipline. How do they relate, a sound mind and self-discipline? If you don't have self-discipline, you're not going to have a sound mind. Your mind is not going to be balanced. It's not going to be calm. It is the discipline that keeps your mind calm and also balanced. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah that he will keep us in perfect peace whose mind is stayed, whose mind is focused. That takes discipline. He promises peace if we focus on him. He then promises peace if we start looking at the wind like Peter did. We're going to sink. We have to focus on him. That takes discipline. Discipline. So he's given us the spirit of discipline. Now, so that's not something we have to do on our own. Just like when the Spirit of God move upon us and we begin to speak another language, or we begin to pray in our prayer language, it's not us doing that. We're just surrendering to what the Spirit brings to the table. And when we discipline ourselves, we have to understand that is the discipline that comes from the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is already equipped to give us sound mind and self-discipline. We're talking about that. We talked about Peter, the reason why Jesus said he was dangerous to him is no self-discipline. No self-discipline. Without self-discipline, you are dangerous to yourself and everybody around you. And Peter didn't have self-discipline. Jesus' response was, deny yourself, take up your cross, follow me daily. You got to discipline yourself. Discipline yourself. Discipline yourself to achieve what you want to achieve, to experience what you want to experience, to enjoy what you want to enjoy, to accomplish what you want to accomplish, to see your potentials to their fullest. Never happen without discipline. Self-discipline. The Bible says this as we are moving towards 2019. The Bible says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse number 24. It says, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receives the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run not as uncertainly, so fight I not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. That's very powerful. Very powerful. And I like the analogies that are used in here. He uses the analogy of an athlete, uses the analogy of a person, or if you will, a boxer. And he's talking about this discipline, and very possibly the discipline of a soldier when you look at that. And he tells us that we ought to strive for the mastery. And we do that by being temperate. Self-control. Self-control. And not just self-control, but long-suffering or patience, endurance. Not just for one day, but for a lifetime. Now, I want to read that in the New Living Translation. Just listen. Same verses. 1 Corinthians 9, chapter 9, verses 24 through 27. Do you realize that in a race, everyone runs, but only one person gets the prize? So run to win. All athletes are disciplined in their training. They do it to win a prize that will fade away. But we do it for an eternal prize. So I run with purpose in every step. I am not just shadow boxing. I discipline my body like an athlete, training it to do what it should. Otherwise, I fear that after preaching to others, I myself might be disqualified. This is Paul. Paul says, now, I have a relationship with Jesus Christ. I've been caught up to the third heaven. I've seen things that I couldn't even explain or even speak. But I still have to discipline myself, or else I'll get disqualified. He understood that the lack of discipline is dangerous. Dangerous. I want to emphasize that, because that I don't think we really get that. It's dangerous to my physical health, my mental health, my financial health, my relational health. It is dangerous to every aspect of my existence. Think about it. No discipline financially, you're on your way to bankruptcy. No discipline physically, then we're on our way to many sicknesses and diseases when we're out of control. It's just the way it is. Discipline. So he says he's like an athlete. He is training. He says in the King James Version, he says, I keep under my body. I keep my body under control. One of the translations he says to us, he says, I beat my body. Think about it. I beat my body. I bring it in subjection. I keep it under control. Now, notice one thing that Paul is saying. It's almost like he is competing against another athlete, or he's in training as a soldier fighting against another enemy. But he's talking about himself. He's saying that I have to do certain things to stay in shape spiritually so I can win against the most dangerous person in our lives, and that is, you guessed it, yourself, myself. So he says, I am striving. I am working. I am fighting. I am beating my flesh. So I won't be a castaway. No one wants to be a castaway. He says, I am going to fight the good fight. And the Bible says it's a good fight because we win. We win. We win. That's the only reason why it's a good fight. So since it's a good fight, there are certain things we have to do. And he talks about this to Timothy being young like Timothy was. He tells Timothy that fight the good fight of faith. And in order to do that, he says, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness.
Stay tuned for more of Frank Stewart. And now for some special announcements.
Thanks for partnering with the Acts Ministries. We value your service and your donations. That's why we've made it easy to make contributions to support our ministry. Simply go to your web browser and click the search bar and type in actsministriesonline.org. Then click Donate Online. It's really that easy. For mobile giving, text the amount you wish to donate to 501-302-4242. That's Simple Give.
And now, more of Pastor Frank Stewart.
He said, now, if you're going to fight the good fight of faith, there's some things you got to incorporate, is some things that you got to subtract. And one of the things he says you got to subtract is the love of money. He's talking to Timothy here in 1 Timothy chapter 6. And he's talking about discipline yourself. He says the love of money is the root of all evil. Do not love that. You cannot serve God and mammoth at the same time. So he's telling him how to be a good soldier. How to fight the good fight of faith. And if we're going to fight the good fight of faith, he says, with godliness and contentment is great gain. And the reason why it's great gain, he says to Timothy in chapter 6 of 1 Timothy, we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we're going to carry nothing out with us. So he's comparing this life like that of a soldier, that of a soldier. So we have to fight the good fight of faith. We have to lay hold to eternal life. It ain't just going to drop in our life, in our laps, I'm sorry. But we have to lay hold to it. We have to fight for it. You know, yes, salvation is free. It's free to us because Jesus died. But there are some things that we have to do. When it says it's free, that means nothing you could have done or I could have done to earn it. But there was a great, great price paid for that. A great price. So he's telling us, using athletes and also using soldiers to tell us the way we should discipline ourselves. He says to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter number 2, he spends a great deal of time talking to Timothy about discipline and self-control and becoming what he was ordained to be. And Paul knew that through even the laying on his hands on Timothy and ordaining him. Look what he says to Timothy and in 2 Timothy chapter 2. Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. He's telling Timothy, just the way you learned it from me, just how I instilled discipline into you, just like I coached you, I trained you, I want you to do the same for other people. You're not going to be able to do that without discipline, because I want you to commit it to them. And he says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier. Hardness. See, notice that now. He's telling Timothy, there's going to be some hard things. What? Cross. The cross. And he says, do it as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. Good soldier of Jesus Christ. You know, we're in the army now. You know, he used to sing that song, "We are in the army now. We're in God's army now. And God can't use any coward soldiers. We're in the army. And there should be a resemblance of our life to the life that we see in a soldier." And he goes on to verse number 4. He says this: "No man that warreth entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who has chosen him to be a soldier. And if a man also strives for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strives lawfully." So Paul is talking to Timothy. He's trying to get Timothy to understand some things here concerning what it is like to fight a good fight, and also what it is like to endure hardness as a good soldier. So he's giving him comparisons to things that Timothy knows. He's keeping it really simple for him. And in the New Living Translation, I'm gonna read the same verses to you, and that's verse 3 and 4. He says, "Endure suffering along with me as a good soldier of Christ Jesus." Soldiers don't get tied up in the affairs of civilian life, for then they cannot please the officer who enlisted them. And athletes cannot win the prize unless they follow the rules. And hard-working farmers should be the first to enjoy the fruit of their labor. Paul is talking about a work ethic. He's talking about a work ethic. And when we look to what the Bible tells us going to happen in the last days, it's going to be a diminishing of the work ethic that God established in man, in mankind, in the beginning, a work ethic. He says, "I want you, Timothy, I want you to know about the hard-working farmer. He's working hard. He should be the first to enjoy the fruit of his labor, but there's hard work that comes with that. There's patience that comes with that." So he has the hard-working farmer, he has the athlete, and he has the soldier. And the thing that they have in common, what he's showing Timothy, there's some discipline. The farmer gets up whether he wants to or not. He gets ready for the harvest whether he wants to or not. So brothers and sisters, when you look at that, I am encouraging you to have the same level of discipline as we move towards 2019. So you will already be in flight when 12 a.m. January 1st, when the clock strike midnight, you're already moving. You're moving at a pace that you could be really the first day of January. You could already be in February with your accomplishment. You could have already been accomplished everything like you would accomplish in January. So think about it, a whole another month to get another month ahead. See it as a double promotion. There are some students that are in high school that are getting college credit. I am telling you, as we move towards 2019, start working on some 2019 credits. Start working on getting ahead. Man, wouldn't it be something that at the end of January, you're already so far ahead. It is as if you had a half a year under your belt because you had such a running start. Discipline. It's not going to change. We don't like it, especially during this time of the year, but he's not going to change. "If any man will come after me, let him take up his cross, follow me daily." Discipline. So now, on this 33rd day, the number of crucifixion, go back and look at what you've learned. Add to it. And every time you add something to it, just see yourself moving, even into 2019, before 2019 gets here, moving from day to day, from to week to week, moving. You got your thrusters on. God created you to be an eagle. An eagle soars. He soars. If you ever gone anywhere by plane and somebody else drove there, when they get there, you already there. That's what I'm saying to you. I'm saying with us, with this countdown, with the preparation we're doing, some people are going to arrive where you are. You're already there. You're already there. When they get where they've been trying to go in the month of March of 2019, you'd have been there since January. He's saying something to us. This is the year. This is the year. Discipline. Discipline. It's no substitute.
For mobile giving, text the amount you wish to donate to 501-302-4242.
The Axe Church in North Little Rock is located at 1224 Franklin Street. Morning glory begins at 8 a.m. on Sunday mornings. Sunday school begins at 8:30 a.m. And for a powerful word, join us at 9:30 a.m. for our morning worship service. Bible study is each Wednesday at 6:30 p.m. At our Conway location, morning glory begins at 10 a.m. Sunday school begins at 10:30 a.m. Worship service begins at 11:30 a.m. On Thursday, our Bible class begins at 6:30 p.m. For more information, go to actsministriesonline.org or give us a call at 501-329-2055.
Thank you for tuning in to the Axe Ministry Podcast. The Axe Church is located at 1423 Ingram Street in Conway and 1224 Franklin Street in North Little Rock, Arkansas. Tune in each day to hear an inspiring word from Pastor Frank